I invite you all to be seated now for a moment, and Philip will share a few thoughts about John to us this morning.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks very much to you all for being here today. Firstly, on behalf of us all as a family, we would like to thank everyone for all the kind messages and support in the days since John's passing. The outpouring of love for John has been overwhelming. The kindness and generosity shown by our neighbours and the people of Merview has been unreal. John was a proud Merview man and always spoke so proudly of how the community support each other in tough times. This has definitely been the case for us this week. We're so grateful to all his friends, neighbours and businesses in the area who stopped by with food, drink and essentials these past few days. We would like to thank all the... He often told us stories from his times working abroad and the many great nights out they enjoyed over the years. We were very honoured to learn that on Monday afternoon they observed a factory-wide minute silence in his memory, and his lab was closed yesterday and today, something unheard of. These gestures will never be forgotten by us. As we all know, John was known as the Bull. He really lived up to this name the last 16 months as he battled ferociously following his diagnosis. Throughout this time, John's battle was greatly aided by the help of some wonderful people who the family would like to thank. Dr. Blaskova and Gemma in UHG, who looked after John so well throughout his illness. They spoke regularly of John's toughness and strength, and this gave us all amazing support, particularly in his final weeks. In fact, on the day we received the news that John was gravely ill, Dr. Blaskova returned from her journey to Portiuncla Hospital to ensure John's comfort was given the utmost priority and to offer support to us all. For this, we'll be forever thankful. We would also like to thank Serica and all the fantastic staff in the Galway Hospice. Their compassion and kind nature throughout John's illness was remarkable. As you know, John was never the most patient of people, but Serica knew just how to handle him. John always spoke very fondly of her and always looked forward to her visits. This definitely made them difficult times easier for John. I'd also like to give a special thanks to my sister Linda. She was by John's side since his first diagnosis, and she stood by his side throughout. Knowing Sully like she did, she knew that John would need support. She always ensured John got the best care and attention possible, and also put manners on him when he was needed occasionally. But most importantly, her love and support for John gave him the courage he needed to battle through his illness. Without question, having Linda by his side gave John that extra strength he needed throughout his battle. John had such love for his family and had a great connection with each and every one of us. As we know, John was the baby of the family, and there was great excitement in Pierce Avenue when he was brought home. Everyone would always be arguing about who would get to feed him, change him or play with him. One particular morning, there was great commotion when it was time to change John's nappy. Martine was adamant that he was going to be the one to do it. Let's just say that was the last nappy Martine ever offered to change, as Sully decided. As Sully decided it was time to give Martine's face a wash. John always kept in contact with all his family far and wide, and we'd like to take this moment to let our family in Australia and America know that we're thinking of them all through this difficult time. There's been one sister in particular he would contact regularly, usually in the early hours of a Sunday morning. More often than not, this phone call would be made around 5 a.m. when John got home, after Juicy finally decided he had enough of listening to himself and Skinner's life lessons. These calls gave me personally endless hours of laughter, as I was lucky enough to hear them as I lay in bed, having been awoken by the full-blown conversation going on below me and the smell of Skinner's taco fries on the kitchen table. John loved all his nieces and nephews and spoke so proudly of them all. He was always at his happiest when surrounded by his girls, singing, laughing and dancing. The endless videos and pictures doing the rounds the last few days are a testament to just how much joy and happiness this gave him. I'd also like to give a special mention to my mother, Colette. Many, many years ago, she took John into our house for what we thought would be 3 weeks. Thankfully, though, John decided to stay with us a little longer. I was lucky enough to have roomed with John for a good portion of these years. In that time, I have many, many memories that I will cherish forever, both good, not so good. John was always so good to Mam, Linda and myself. He was always there whenever we needed, and we created a special bond as a family that will live on forever. John had many great passions in life, Galway hurling being one. He had many great days where he watched his beloved Galway. He was an avid supporter and travelled all around the country to games with the lads, often leaving Kennedy's at about 20 past 8 in the morning to grab the bus at 8:30. John also had a great love of music. He loved everything from Rory Gallagher to Thin Lizzy, Oasis to Nirvana, and the Beatles to the Stones. You were always guaranteed a good time when Sully was at the jukebox. I think it's safe to say there were not too many bigger Arsenal fans around than Sully. As a team, they occasionally brought him joy, but they always brought him plenty of heartbreak and frustration. Watching a match in Sully's company was definitely an experience. When they were doing well, there were no issues, but when they were losing, take cover and insert your earplugs. This season, John got to see Arsenal back at their very best, back at the top of the table, fighting for the championship. But he also took fantastic comfort in the fact that Spurs are doing so bad. Lastly, I'd just like to give a special mention to his partner in crime and best buddy, Skinner. The pair of you had a friendship like no other. You made a lasting impression on everyone that has been lucky enough to cross your paths. You were together through the good times and bad, never more so than in the past 16 months. You always kept Sully's spirits high and gave him hope when he needed it most. We as a family would like to thank you from the bottom of our hearts for everything. Finally, we'd just like to invite everyone to Kennedy's this evening, where we'll celebrate John's life and tell the real stories about him. And thanks very much.
I invite you now to stand for the beginning of our Mass. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Good morning, everybody. You're all very, very welcome as you gather here in the Holy Family Church in Merview for the final farewell Mass for John O'Sullivan. First of all, I'd like to thank you, Philip, for the lovely background that you gave to us about your uncle, Sully. I welcome you all here this morning, but I would particularly like to welcome his family, his brothers, Mickey, Jerry, and Martin, his sisters, Margaret, Mary, Etha, Carmel, and Colette. I like him, welcome his brother-in-laws, sister-in-laws, his nephews, nieces, grandnephews, and grandnieces, and the extended family, neighbours, and the many friends that have joined him here this morning. A special warm welcome to you, Ray, who has been by his side when he needed you most. I want to welcome those that have joined us online this morning, and if anybody has joined us from any other country outside our own, you're very, very welcome here to our church in Merview on the edge of Galway City. And as we gather to celebrate John's life, I know we're all very familiar with the word Mass and the word Eucharist, but if you go back to the real meaning of the word Eucharist, it's a thanksgiving. So really, what we are doing here this morning is participating in the Eucharist, thanking God for the life and times of John O'Sullivan. And so for a moment, in the silence of our own hearts, let us pause, reflect on our own lives, and ask God's pardon and forgiveness. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask the Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Let us pray. Listen kindly to our prayers, O Lord. As our faith in your Son, raised from the dead, is deepened, may our hope of resurrection for your departed servant John always find new strength through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. And now I invite you all to be seated for our first and second reading, and our psalm will be sung, I'm sure.
First reading, a reading from the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, for all peoples, God is preparing a banquet of rich food. On this mountain, he has destroyed the veil which used to conceal all peoples, the dark cloud enveloping all nations. He has destroyed death forever. Lord God has wiped away the tears from every cheek. He has taken people's shame away everywhere on earth, for God has spoken. On that day, it will be said, look, this is our God. In him, we put our hope that he should save us. This is God. We put our hope in him. Let us exult and rejoice since he has saved us. This is the word of the Lord.
He makes me ride in pastures green. The second reading, a reading from the first letter of St. John. How great is the love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will has not yet been made known. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. This is the word of the Lord.
I invite you now to stand to greet the gospel. Alleluia, alleluia. Come, you whom my Father has blessed, says the Lord. Take for your heritage the kingdom prepared for you since the foundation of the world. Alleluia. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. This little gospel that I chose for his funeral this morning, I had the very good experience of standing on the same hill looking over into the Lake of Galilee, where Jesus had the tradition of being when he sat his disciples down and said those things to them. Seeing the crowds, Jesus went up the hill. There he sat down and was joined by his disciples. Then he began to speak, and this is what he taught them. How happy are the poor in spirit, theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Happy the gentle, they shall have the earth for their heritage. Happy those who mourn, they shall be comforted. Happy those who hunger and thirst for what is right, they shall be satisfied. Happy the merciful, they shall have mercy shown them. Happy the pure in heart, they shall see God. Happy the peacemakers, they shall be called children of God. Happy those who are persecuted in the cause of right, theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And this is the gospel of the Lord. And now you can be seated for a little moment or two. The vast majority of you here in this church this morning has a big advantage over me, because most of you would have known John. You'd have known him as a brother growing up in the family home, a stone's throw from this church. You would have known him as a teenager. You'd have known him in his work. You'd have known him having a drink in Kennedy's. You'd have known him going off to support Arsenal in the buses. But for me, I didn't know John. But mind you, that's not the full story either. Because the other morning, I went up to the house and I met Philip. And during the course of a nice cup of tea, I really got a sense of John. And believe it or not, and I didn't tell Philip this the other day, I shared two passions with him. First of all, my interest in hurling, which he had. The only difference, of course, is that I'd be at one side of the television roaring for Clare, and he'd be at the other side shouting for Galway. And believe it or not, my soccer team in England is Arsenal, and I truly enjoyed Arsenal's journey, particularly this year, but also over many, many years. But I suppose, like John, I had a sense that they would be caught at the end, and they were, of course, this year. Sometimes, you know, people think that when we say something, that what we say will be remembered. But you know, the reality of the story in life is that we almost always forget what people say and tell us. But the one thing that we never forget is the feeling that we get when we meet somebody and talk to them over a period of time. And I must confess, talking to Philip and his family the other morning, I immediately got the sense of the warmth of John O'Sullivan. He was obviously somebody that touched the lives of many people by his warmth and his personality and his friendship. And that is a reality. And as I said to Philip this morning, you can be sure if I pass away here in this parish that there'll be no BQ outside the church for me like there was yesterday evening or again today. John had that lovely personality that touched the lives of people. But there is another side to that coin, and it is this. When we meet genuine people and when we develop genuine relationships with those people, it has its own story too, especially when they are taken from us, because their going leaves a vacancy in our hearts and in our homes. And I have no doubt that the home for over 30 years of John in Barry Avenue, his going in the past week will leave a vacancy there, and especially a vacancy in Philip and Linda and his sister, and particularly with all their own immediate family. There is always sadness in parting with somebody that we have developed genuine and lifelong relationships with. And there are many people here in this church that were friends with John that will miss him greatly, not just this week, but for weeks, months, and years ahead. And let me go back to the analogy of sport. John would be well aware that there are two halves in every game. And the second half of the game that John had to live through wasn't a very pleasant one. As Philip has already mentioned, he suffered in the last closing days, months of his life. But in his sickness and in his challenges, he was blessed with the support that he got from all those around him. And Philip rightly so acknowledged them and thanked them this morning. And I will finish with that lovely reading from the Old Testament from the prophet of Isaiah. On this mountain for all peoples, God is preparing a banquet of rich food. On this mountain, he has destroyed the veil which used to conceal of all peoples, the dark cloud enveloping all nations. On this mountain, the Lord will wipe away the tears from every cheek. He has taken his people's shame away everywhere on earth, for God has spoken. The suffering and the pain that John had to endure over the last number of months has all ceased. And with God's grace, God's blessing, he has joined God on that mountain where there is a banquet of rich food, of peace, no tears, and no sadness. May his gentle soul rest in the arms of God for all eternity. And with those few little thoughts, I invite those that are to share the prayers of the faithful to come forward with us with their prayers, and we'll stand now for the prayers of the faithful.
We give thanks for the love which John showed during his life. May he know the perfection and fulfillment of that love in heaven.
Lord, hear us.
Let us pray for John. In baptism he died with Christ. May he now share in the fulfillment of the resurrection. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for those who care for the sick. We give thanks for the skills and the commitment of doctors and nurses, in particular Dr. Blazkova and her team, and associate and staff at the Galway Hospice. They looked after John so well. May they continue to reflect the compassion and healing of God, who is made known to us in Christ. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For all who mourn today, that they will receive strength to assist them in their sadness and grief. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Today we remember all who have died, in particular John's brother Jimmy and his great friend Benny. Today may they enjoy the promise of eternal happiness. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously.
Kilkenny 2:15. Limerick 1:5. Man's old.
And I suppose the person that knew what suffering was really about was Mary, the mother of Jesus, as she saw her son die. And today, on her month, we'll all join together in saying a prayer for John's family. And we remember too this morning the Walsh's family, whose mother we buried yesterday. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. These are our prayers, and we make them now through Jesus, who lives and reigns, one God forever and ever. Amen. And now you can be seated as the offertory gifts are brought to the altar. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth, work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life. By the mystery of this water and wine, may we come to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine, work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink. Pray now, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Look favorably on our offerings, O Lord, so that your departed servant John may be taken up into glory with your Son, whose great mystery of love we are all united through Christ our Lord. And the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For as one alone he accepted death, so that we might all escape from dying. As one man he chose to die, so that in your sight we might live forever. And so, in the company of the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we proclaim. Holy, and you can kneel or be seated for our Eucharistic prayer. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, with Michael our Bishop, and all of us. Remember your servant, John O'Sullivan, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. And now I invite you all to stand. And at the Saviour's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say together, Our Father, hallowed be thy name, and thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin, safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. And the peace of the risen Lord be with you always. And let us pause for a little moment now and pray for the most precious gift in the world, the gift of peace. Lamb of God, take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of Christ keep us all safe for eternal life. Amen. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Whoever believes in me, even though he dies, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will not die forever. Alleluia, alleluia. And now I invite you to stand for the final prayer of the Mass. Grant, we pray, O Lord, that your servant John, for whom we have celebrated this funeral Mass, may pass over to a dwelling place of light and peace. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Just before the final blessing, could I thank all of you for joining the family and being with them at this difficult and challenging time this morning here at this Mass. Could I thank everybody who participated in the liturgy, that did the readings and the prayers of the faithful, and thank you, Philip, especially for your words. It's never easy to come up here and have to do that kind of a task. I want to thank our singers and our musicians for the lovely hymns that they have shared with us. And now we'll ask God's blessing in us all. The Lord be with you all. Let us bless the Lord. And we can continue now to stand for the final commendation prayers. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother John. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. I will bless his remains now with holy water, reminding us that he became a member of God's family at baptism. I will incense his remains with incense, reminding us of the dignity of the human person. And your response to the psalm is, receive his soul and present him to God the Most High. Saints of God, come to his aid, hasten to meet him, angels of the Lord. May Christ, who called you, take you to himself. May angels lead you to the bosom of Abraham. Eternal rest grant to him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother John, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise of him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon him in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn towards us, listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain to comfort one another with the assurance of faith until we all meet in Christ and we are with our brother forever. In peace now, let us take our brother John to his final resting place. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.